All right, let's stand together for the reading of God's Word. I'd like you to find 1 Corinthians chapter 4 this morning. 1 Corinthians chapter 4. We're going to look at a few verses there in the opening of that chapter. I'll speak to you this morning about the mysteries of Christmas. The mysteries of Christmas. And there are many, far more than I have time to develop it with any detail this morning. But we'll pick a select array of the mysteries of Christmas in hopes that you will recapture the real wonder of that day. The Bible says in 1 Corinthians chapter 4, beginning at verse number 1, "Let a man so account of us as the ministers of Christ and stewards of the mysteries of God. Moreover, it is required in stewards that a man be found faithful." He goes on to develop an important point, of course, he's making with the Corinthians there. But I thought I'd zero in on that expression, being stewards of the mysteries of God. It's plural. We think usually of the mystery of Christ, and that's a specific mystery. It's included in the number of mysteries, but there are mysteries. We'll be looking this morning at the mysteries of Christmas. Father, help me to preach, and these to be attentive with ears of faith, ears that hear, and to see, Lord, what you have to show us this morning from the Scripture. And except you open our eyes, well, it'll just get right past us. It'll be like those who walked with you on the road to Emmaus, and you were with them all that time, and they didn't see you till you opened their eyes. We don't want to be sitting here, Lord, during the course of this message, unable to see, unable to hear. So I pray, Father, you'll help us to see and help us to hear as you show us what you want us to look at this morning concerning this celebration of the birth of your Son, and so that we will hear the message of it in our hearts. In Jesus' name I pray for that. Amen. Thank you. You may be seated. You know, the night was pretty special, wasn't it? The Christmas night when Jesus was born. A lot of interesting things went on. The word Christmas means Christ sent. And so this season is well named because Christ was sent into the world to save sinners. And he came into the world to seek and to save that which was lost. He was sent to save us. And this word mystery fundamentally means secret, but there's another word that could be used for secret. When this word is used, it means a special secret. Something startling, perhaps something that's reserved until the time was right for it to be revealed. This mystery, something surprising, something that intrigues or mystifies. So let's look a little bit at the general mysteries of Christmas that you would think about. I mean, it's pretty mysterious, this whole thing of an angel showing up and talking to anybody at any time. And that God would use the angel Gabriel, well, that's kind of special. Gabriel was the angel that God used to give the prophecies concerning the coming of Christ to Daniel. Those special prophecies that we looked at this morning, or that one particularly in Daniel 9, from which we can calculate the very year of his death, and history and prophecy converge in agreement on the time of his birth. It's interesting. We did that work this morning in our Bible study. It's mysterious. How amazing. Of course, with no secret to you or to me, and we're not necessarily surprised, but, you know, the world gets all excited if Nostradamus gets kind of close in his prophecies. They get a little excited about that. But when it comes to the Bible gets not just close but dead on, and they yawn. That's because the world just can't hear it. They can't see it. They don't get it. But we do. It's wonderful. The miraculous hand of providence in which God directed the affairs in the life of Joseph and Mary so that they would be in Bethlehem the night of Christ's birth. All of that is very, very interesting. Where God's moving the hearts of kings and nations and moving everything into place. And that's just a wonderful story. And then the story of the miraculous star that appeared to those magi of the east who followed it all the way to Jerusalem. And then it disappears and they go talk to Herod. And when they get done with that conversation, they come out and there it is again, and it leads them to Bethlehem and all of that. All of that was included in some things we talked about already coming up to this message. So we're going to look at some other mysteries this morning. Let's look first of all at this one. The Bible calls it the mystery of godliness. God manifest in the flesh. Open your Bible to 1 Timothy chapter 3:16. 1 Timothy 3:16. Great is the mystery of godliness. God manifest in the flesh. In the prophecy concerning Jesus, Isaiah chapter 7:14, we're told that his name shall be called Emmanuel. And we do call the name Jesus Emmanuel, don't we? That is, we say Jesus is God with us. The word Emmanuel means God with us. And the prophecy declared that his name would be called God with us. And his name is Jesus. And Jesus is God with us. And that's a beautiful, beautiful mystery. That God would become man. Now, just contemplating the wonder of that would be enough to take up the entire message. So we're going to try to abbreviate our comments here, but just give that a thought. I mean, that's a whole lot more amazing than a fat guy getting down a chimney. All right? Or a skinny guy who's offended by all the people that call him fat. Never mind. This whole business of, cookies and milk disappearing over the night when you get up in the next morning. Don't let the world steal the real wonders of Christmas. Because the real wonder, the real amazing thing about Christmas is this. God became man. And that's a wonderful thought when you think about it. God being who he is, eternal, who fills up eternity. He inhabits eternity. And the language there indicates that he fills it up. You can't get anywhere in time where he isn't. And so he's just like big. He's high and lifted up. And he's glorious. He's magnificent. The amazing angels, those seraphim, saying, "Holy, holy, holy, Lord God Almighty." Read Revelation 4 and 5 a little later on today and just get a sense of his glory and his majesty. Read Isaiah 6 and just contemplate the power of creation, the mighty God. Think of who this is. When we say God manifests in the flesh, think of who God is. Manifest in flesh. That's amazing. That's incredible. That somehow God would contrive a way to connect himself to the seed of the woman and germinate into existence this that has never before been. God. In flesh. Wow. That's an amazing thing to think about. How does that happen? Well, the Bible says that the Word is the incorruptible seed. And the Bible says in John 1:1, in the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. And so the Word joined with the seed of the woman and produced this amazing new creature. A new creation, something brand spanking new. Everybody likes something new. Well, here it is. God took the seed of the Word, joined it to the seed of the woman, and germinated a life that was God, but man. Was man, but God. No, he was God and man. He was man and God. Well, no, there's not language that really does the work we need done here. Because this that was conceived in the womb of Mary was God. Wholly and completely and entirely God. At the same time, this that was conceived in the womb of Mary was man. Wholly and entirely and completely man. There isn't a duality here. There's a kind of fusion where these became one. It's just, and that language isn't even sufficient to the work. I do a lot of work in theology. It's my forte, as they say, and contemplating this particular mystery takes pages and pages and pages. The forests in Africa shook with fear when I took pen to paper to write this. Because it took a lot of, I'm just trying to make a point that I don't seem to be making. This is an amazing, amazing thing that happened in the womb of Mary. It's just mind-bogglingly incredible. God. God. In the beginning, God created the heaven and the earth. Boom! God. You know how big the heaven and the earth comprise? I mean, this is huge. Trying to measure distance between planets, and then you get to the measured distance between stars, and you start trying to work all this out. And if you've done any reading on this or any study in this, it is mind-staggering, mind-boggling. Huge. Some of these stars out there are like, what, millions of our star, the sun. It's just, sometimes the best way to express something is just like, That's biblical. You're surprised. No, in Exodus, Moses got so overwhelmed, his expression was translated in the Bible with a hyphen. Just, It's, It's huge. It's amazing. God! God! Manifest in flesh. Flesh. This stuff. Flesh. It's incredible to think about, to contemplate how the seed that is the Word joined the seed that is the woman's seed, as prophesied in Genesis 3, 15 and 16, and how that produced a brand new something that never before existed. Now, of course, the Son of God, eternity past, the second person of the Godhead, I get that, and all, but never as flesh. Now, he's flesh. He became man. He became one of us. God made us in his image and after his likeness. But he didn't, of course, hit the duplicate key. Right? What is it on your Windows computers? I don't know. On mine, it's Apple D. Duplicate. Right? I don't know what you guys do in the Windows world. But Apple D, boom, we got a duplicate. Then it's the exact same thing. It's another of the same thing. Well, when God created Adam and Eve, he didn't hit the duplicate key. He didn't communicate to man omnipotence. He didn't communicate to man omniscience. He didn't communicate to man omnipresence. He didn't communicate to man a lot of the qualities and attributes that are part of who he is and what he is. But he nevertheless made us in his image and after his likeness, and it was his desire to complete that project. And I can't get too much into all of that right now, although it's a lot of fun, and we'll do it some other time. The fact is, man sinned, destroyed that image. He broke it, busted it all to pieces, destroyed it so that man is so unlike God now. So not like him. Originally, in God's heart, it was his intent that he would make a man after his likeness and after his image. And he did, and there he was. And yet this man took that free gift of free will, that gracious gift of free will, and used it to turn his heart against the Lord. And he went away from the Lord, and he went into the hands of Satan. The Bible teaches us that he became a child of the devil and broke that image. What a treasure to have and then to despise. What a glory to have. And the irony is that Eve did it in pursuit of the very thing God was giving to them. You'll be like God to know good and evil. You know, you'll be like God. And so she goes after what it is God had already given her and ends up destroying it. It's just a mess. And look at the sin that came into the world. The evil, that came into the world through that sin. And the damage and the havoc and the wars and the rumors of wars and all the terrible things that have come into the world because of that. Because man took that beautiful gift of the image and likeness of God and sullied it with sin. So what's God going to do? In order to redeem man, he had to become man. So the Creator becomes what he created. This is bizarre. You talk about mysteries. Wow. This is strange. Creator God becomes created man. How does that happen? So God, the Creator, doesn't stop being the Creator, but he becomes the created, which doesn't stop being the created. Maybe this is a little bit too, you know, systematic theology for you guys. How many of you are enjoying this so far? Okay, we got four or five people that aren't. We'll get to you later. The fact is, God became man, and when he became man, that was significant because he became what he created and restored that image and likeness that he originally designed. He restored that in Jesus. So Jesus is what we call the last Adam. The Bible calls him last Adam. So the first Adam was made. He blew it. So God, I don't know if you say he did a do-over. That really isn't, that doesn't come close, because God himself became the man that he had created before back there in the Garden of Eden. Now he becomes that. And the reason that's important is because according to God's economy and the way he has organized everything, he put all things that he made under the foot of Adam. He put it all at his feet. The Bible says that. He made all this, and then he made Adam the crown of his creation, and he put under Adam's feet all that he made. It's amazing. And so when Adam turned his back on God and went after Satan, Satan became usurper God of this world. And so God wants it back, and he wants man back, and he wants to save man. But man is under bondage to sin now. And Satan can do with them as he pleases. The Bible says Satan can take them captive at his will. And Satan has come to kill, to maim, to destroy. Satan has come to bring whatever misery he can. He wants to, well, he just absolutely hates it that you have the image and likeness of God. He hates that because that's what he wanted. He said, I will be like the Most High. And God said, no, you won't. And cast him down, took dirt, made man. And from that man made of clay or of dirt, or to that man made of clay and dirt, God gave the dominion, and Satan is seething with hatred. And he wants to destroy mankind. And so God came himself, joined his seed with the, you know, the word, with the seed of the woman, and made another Adam, called in the Bible the last Adam. And of course, he didn't break the image. He didn't sully it. He was tempted in every point like we are, but without sin. And so he conquered death and hell. He conquered Satan. Satan had the power of death because he had tempted man into sin, and the wages of sin is death. And the whole world was under the power of Satan because he had the power of death. The Bible says that God sent his Son, the Lamb of God, who would be the sacrifice that would pay for all the sins of all mankind. It's an amazing truth. It's incredible. It's mysterious how God worked all this out, and it's a beautiful story how he sent himself, he brought himself as in the person of his Son into the womb of Mary, through the womb of Mary, called him Jesus because he would save us from our sins, and he went about doing good, of course, and never sinning, though tempted like we are, never failing, so that he went to the cross of Calvary as God's pure and perfect and sinless Lamb. John the Baptist identified him, the Lamb of God that taketh away the sin of the world. Interesting, the sin of the world. goes to another interesting mystery. And for time's sake, I won't go back and read through the entire passage, but you read about it in the Gospel of John chapter 6 and in chapter 12. I might get into it a little bit later on, but when you read those later on, you'll see Jesus Christ connects together his authority to judge all mankind to his incarnation, because he's the Son of Man. And because he's the Son of Man, Son of God, because he's both, therefore, with God's authority and as man, he can judge all man. Now watch this. This is really amazing. So God sends his Son into the world, who becomes a man, Christ the Lord, and the Lord Jesus Christ, the Lamb of God, dies on the cross of Calvary. He's buried. On the third day, he rises again from the dead. And don't worry, I'm not going to fall off. But he rises again from the dead, and he declares, all power is given unto me in heaven and earth. And he says in John chapter 6 and in John chapter 12 that the Father has given all judgment to me. Jesus said that. He said, all judgment over mankind is given to me. All of it. The Father had it, but he gave it to me. I have it now. And Jesus Christ says that the day will come when he will speak and all that are in the grave will hear his voice and they'll all come up. Wow. And I hope I can get this across, because it's kind of an interesting thing. Because see, here's what happened. Satan had man under his power. Jesus came and broke his power. And now Jesus has the power. And Satan does not. Which means you don't have to live for the devil anymore. He broke Satan's power on the cross of Calvary. He rose again. He said, all power is mine now. At the beginning of Jesus' ministry, public ministry, Satan said, all the kingdoms of the world are mine. All this glory I'm going to give to you. At the end, when Jesus rose again, now it's all mine now. All the power is mine. Exousia, authority, right to rule. Same word used in Romans 13. All power is ordained of God. That's the power Jesus said he had. All of it's his. Jesus Christ has it all now. He spoiled all principality and power. We wrestle against principalities, against powers, against the rulers of darkness. Jesus spoiled them. We wrestle them. Here's where I'm going with this. Jesus Christ conquered Satan, took all that power to himself, and he gave to us liberty and freedom and power to overcome the devil, but we don't do it. We give the devil place. We allow him to have room in our lives, and we sin. We do foolish and stupid things, and we allow the devil then to gain some advantage in our lives. Paul warned about churches letting Satan get the advantage of them. Paul talked about how Satan hindered him from ministry situations. Satan is active in our lives. When we say that Jesus Christ defeated him and broke his power, we don't mean that Jesus Christ has entirely removed his influence from the earth. The Bible says in Ephesians chapter 2, 1 and 2, that Satan is the prince of the power of the air, the spirit that now works in the children of disobedience. And so, however, Jesus Christ's spirit is in us, and his spirit in us opposes the spirit in them, and there's this war going on. And all I'm saying right now is this is really mysterious stuff. You see, because right now, because Jesus died on the cross of Calvary, he freed the whole world from the power of Satan. He freed the whole world. Yeah. He gave a parable. He talked about spying a treasure in the field and then going and buying, selling everything he had and coming and buying that field in order he might have that treasure. But he bought the whole field to get the treasure. He bought the whole field to get that treasure. You understand what I'm saying? He bought the whole field. The whole field is his. He bought to get that treasure, which is the church, the bride of Christ. He spied in the world a treasure. He sold everything he had, and he came and bought the world. It's all his. Jesus Christ is king, and all men are his subjects. No one is under the authority of Satan. The only people who are under the authority or working with Satan are doing it in rebellion against Christ. This is a concept thing you need to think about a little bit here. All of our friends who are in the world that are serving Satan, they're doing it in rebellion against the claim of Christ to be their Lord. Jesus has the right to claim lordship over every human being. Nobody makes Jesus Lord. You just confess something that's true. Nobody can make Jesus Lord except God. God is the one who makes Jesus Lord. What we do is we submit to that fact. He is Lord. And he is the Lord of every lost person you know. If you're in this room right now and you don't know Jesus Christ as your Savior, guess what? Jesus is your Lord. You need to confess with your mouth that truth and believe in your heart. God raised him from the dead, and then you'll be saved from the wrath your Lord is going to bring upon this world when he comes back. But make no mistake about it, he is Lord. And one day, every knee will bow and every tongue will confess Jesus Christ is Lord to the glory of God the Father. Because he is Lord. Oh, Jesus isn't my Lord. Yes, he is your Lord. And you're living in disobedience to your Lord. You're rejecting him. Actively resisting him. This is part of the mystery of Christmas. Let me bring this together and help you see that. Watch. So when Jesus Christ died upon the cross of Calvary, he died for our sins, but not for ours only. He died for the sins of the whole world. See, Satan had the power of death. The Bible says he had, past tense, the power of death. Now Jesus has it. You see, you're not even going to get away from him in hell. You can't even get out from under his lordship in hell. You can't even escape his lordship in death. It's just, he's your Lord. Let me make it more clear for you. When Jesus Christ died upon the cross of Calvary, he broke the power of sin over the entire world. Now, some people make the mistake of thinking, well, what does that mean? Does that mean we don't sin? I think it's pretty obvious that isn't what it means. Okay? I mean, even for a Christian, even for a believer, when you get saved, do you stop sinning entirely? No. Things change. You have a different perspective. You have a different center. Your focus completely changes. A lot of things change in your life. But nobody here is going to say, you don't sin. If you do, you're a liar. Holy Ghost already told us that. If any man say that he have no sin, he's a liar and truth is not in him. And any man includes, well, like any man, including a saved man or a lost man, every man. So we have it, this idea that Jesus Christ broke the power of sin over you doesn't mean that you are no longer going to sin. It does mean, first, you don't have to, and number two, you can escape it. You can get out from under it. You have a way out. You can turn to Jesus Christ, confess him as Lord, believe on him in your heart, and the Bible says that Jesus will wash away all your sins. And he died on the cross of Calvary to make that possible for everybody. He died for our sins, not for ours only, but for the sins of the whole world. In other words, not only is it true of every lost person you know, every person who doesn't know Christ, every person who isn't a Christian and so on, whatever nomenclature you use to identify the distinction between somebody who is a Christian and somebody who isn't, you might have different ways of expressing that, but all of those who you would put in the category of aren't, every one of them is under the lordship of Jesus. And every one of them has had their sins paid for. The sins have been paid for. 1 John chapter 2, verses 1 and 2. He is the propitiation. That is the satisfaction, the atonement, the payment for our sins. And not for ours only, but for the sins of the whole world. So you got this thing called the world. Got a whole bunch of people on it. Satan held it in his power. By the power of death. The wages of sin is death. But Jesus Christ came and he took that power into his own hands. All judgment now is his. The accuser has been defanged. This is sort of a way to look at this. His accusations are virtually meaningless if you're under the blood of Christ. It's a beautiful thing. And he did that for everybody, Nathan, everybody. He died for your neighbors just as much as he died for you. And so when he died, it meant something. It actually accomplished something. What did it do? It broke the power of sin to hold you in the devil's grasp. You don't have to stay in sin. You don't have to stay in the devil's service. In fact, you're commanded not to. You're commanded to repent. The Bible says in Acts 17:30, God commands all men everywhere to repent. You're commanded to do that. What does that mean, to repent? The Apostle Paul explained it clearly in Acts 26. He told us that he preached repentance, which meant that they would turn from darkness to light. They would turn from the power of Satan to God. And the reason you can do that is because Jesus died on the cross and broke the power of sin and broke the power of death. So the only reason you go to hell is because you refuse to yield to Jesus the Lord. See, Jesus explained it this way. These fellows who don't believe, you know why they don't believe? Because they love darkness more than light. Remember he said that? John chapter 3, verses 17 to 21. They love darkness more than light. That's why they don't believe. Now, you're talking to some sinner, he's going to tell you all the reasons he doesn't believe. Well, there's just not enough evidence. Now, the Bible's been debunked a long time ago. Darwin's evolutionary theory has been proved right. Blah, 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 blah. And you could spend 5 hours showing them how foolish that is, and I don't think that's necessarily a bad idea. It's good, you know, to give an answer for the faith. So go ahead and take the time and work them through all the realities that they seem to be overlooking. Evolutionary theory has never been proved. It's still a theory. Now we can go on and on and on with all of that. But Jesus just went right to the heart of it, didn't he? He just cut to the chase. He didn't say the reason men don't believe is because they're confused by all these things. He didn't even say the reason men don't believe is because they're blinded by the devil. The Bible says Satan blinds the eyes of those who obey not the gospel of Jesus Christ. There is an activity by which Satan keeps the mind of lost people from turning to the Lord. He's busy trying to keep you from receiving Christ. He's busy with that. But Jesus, he didn't even say that. It's interesting what Jesus said. He said, the reason men don't believe is because they love darkness more than light. The only way Satan can keep anybody blind is because of their affection for darkness. It's a heart issue. So we ask the Lord Jesus, well, why do they love darkness? I mean, what sense does that make? Why would anybody love darkness? And Jesus said, here's why. Their deeds are evil. They're evil deed doers. They do evil. They live in evil. What is it to live in evil? To live in rebellion against God. That's what it is. So, their affection is set on darkness, and their activity is committed to doing those things that bring evil into the world. And what are those things that bring evil into the world? Sin. The Bible teaches that God created evil. He didn't create sin. That manifests in the heart of a man who takes his free will and turns it against God. Get into that some other time in more detail, but the bottom line is, sin is a trespass of a law. God said, don't do this or do that. And if you do what you're not supposed to do or don't do what you're supposed to do, then that's a sin. And when you sin, evil comes into the world. Now, here's the problem. Men have an affection for darkness because their deeds are evil. That's why. That's what Jesus said. That's how he explained it. And then he went on to say something else very interesting. He said, those who do good, they come to the truth. Or those who do truth, excuse me, come to the light. Those who do truth come to the light. How do you do truth? What's doing truth? Well, it's doing what God told you to do. God told you to repent and believe on Jesus. And that's the truth, man. We're not saved by works of righteousness which we have done, but by his grace. For by grace are you saved through faith, and not of yourselves. It is the gift of God, not of works, lest any man should boast. We cannot do any righteousness that would amount to anything that would require God to honor it with the gift of eternal life. For even our righteousnesses are as filthy rags. But Jesus made a very interesting observation when he was talking about this throwing the seed stuff out there. And he said, you throw the seed on one kind of ground and it's stony and this happens, and on hard and this happens, and right? And he talks about the good soil. And then he describes the good soil in Luke as being a good and honest heart. Hasn't Jesus read The Institutes of the Christian Religion by John Calvin? Doesn't he know that there's no such thing? That's because people confuse these things and make a big mess out of it. Let me make it very simple for you. God has dealt to every man the measure of faith. He has lighted every man that's come into the world. If the gospel comes to a heart that does truth, listen, that does truth, it's honest. Honest about himself. I'm a sinner. I'm in trouble. I deserve God's judgment. I acknowledge that. God has commanded me to repent. He has a right to command me to that. And I'm in trouble if I don't. And I ought to be in trouble if I don't. He's God and I'm not. It's just your heart that does truth. A heart that will take truth, that will respond to truth. That faith that God has put in our heart, when it responds to truth, opens the door to grace. And God's grace moves into our heart through our faith and then ministers healing to our soul. These are mysterious things that only happen because Jesus came into the world as a man and on our behalf, representing us, died on the cross, paying the sin debt. You understand that when Adam sinned, every human being coming from him was born a sinner. Now, I wonder if you got one of those hearts that respond to that truth with agreement and acceptance. Or do you have one of those hearts that go, no, that's not true. And you argue with the Bible and you argue with God. If you have a heart that argues with God, I can tell you why. There's some kind of sin in your life that you like doing and you don't want to give it up. It's as simple as that. There's something in your life that you know is not compatible with becoming a Christian. Now, it isn't true that giving that up will make you a Christian. It is true, however, that your love for that and your affection for that and your stubborn rebellion against your Creator, your God, your resistance to the authority of the Lord Jesus, who is right now in a mysterious way actually speaking to you, not me. I'm just throwing some words out there. He uses the truthfulness and the words to minister grace to your heart. But if there's no faith there responding to the truth declared, then the grace won't get in. And that's all mysterious stuff. So, if you're one of those whose heart, faith is responding, you hear the word truth, and you yield to it. Say, yes, that's true. I do truth. Then you're a truth doer. You see what I mean? Didn't talk about you live righteously, you never do wrong. That's not what it's talking about. You're doing truth. Your heart isn't attached to some lie that provides cover for you to stay away from the truth. When our faith gets attached to a lie, which is what Satan likes to do, give us a lie that we'll believe like Eve did, and that'll corrupt that faith and pervert it into unbelief. But if your faith isn't attached to some lie that's keeping you from hearing the truth statements that I'm offering this morning, then your heart is going, yeah. All have sinned and come short of the glory of God. All our righteousnesses are as filthy rags. There's none righteous, no, not one. The Bible says that nobody can go to heaven except through Jesus Christ. That's it. There is no other way. Jesus said, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No man cometh unto the Father but by me. See, if your heart responds to those sorts of declarations with a humble surrender to the truth of it, then you're doing truth. But if your affections are wrapped up on darkness, because darkness provides a place where you can create a system of thinking, a philosophy of life that allows you to do what you want to do contrary to God, that allows you to dismiss those truth claims from the Bible, that allows you see what I'm trying to say? Then that's why you don't believe. That's Jesus' diagnosis of you. Your problem is your affections are set on darkness, and that's because you do evil things. But I know this, the people who do truth, they come to the light. They're different. When the light is turned on, they're attracted to it. They come to it. When the light's turned on to a darkness lover, they turn away from it. But when the light is turned on to a heart that does truth, then they're attracted to it. They look at it and they come to it. Jesus said that. They will come to it. They will come to the light. They'll be drawn to it and they'll be brought to it. He said, I will draw all men unto me. Right now in this room, the mystery of Christmas is happening. Christ, who was sent into the world, the Lamb of God to take away the sin of the world, has died upon the cross of Calvary and broken the power of sin over you right now, so that the Holy Spirit, whom he sent into the world to reprove the world of sin, righteousness, and judgment, will be doing that right now. And he's doing that right now. And right now, this whole mysterious thing's going on. If you're a lover of darkness, then you fight against the truth statements from the Bible. If you're a truth doer, then these declarations of the light from God's word attract you. And you move toward that light, the light of God's word. And you turn from the power of Satan to God. And the reason you can do that is because Jesus died on the cross and broke the power. He can't hold you. He said, well, I'm too much of a sinner. That's what I said. On that December day, many, many years ago, I was 16 years old, sitting in a little church, and a preacher preached on the gospel, preached the gospel to us out of the Gospel of Matthew, and he explained all these things that I had read the Gospel of Matthew many times, but I didn't catch so much of what he was talking about. And I saw that because one thing was for real about me. I was honest in that regard. You know, I wasn't deceitful. I didn't pretend that I was some kind of a good person. And I hated my life, and I hated the whole mess. I hated what I saw going on around me. I didn't have any affection for that junk, but I felt stuck in it, trapped. And he talked about how Jesus died on the cross of Calvary and broke the power of sin, and he shared some of the things I'm sharing with you. And as I listened to him, that light was attractive to me. I thought, wow, that's good news. That's good. Listen, forgiveness of sin is not good news to a man who doesn't believe he needs it. Having your sins washed away is not good news to a man who likes sinning. But somebody who wants to be delivered, who wants to be saved, who wants to be brought out of that and looking for the light that would show them the way, well, when that light gets turned on and when the gospel is preached and he sees it, he says he goes to it, you see. That's what Jesus said. That fellow will go to the light. He'll come to the light. So, are you going to take advantage of the mysteries of Christmas this morning? I got so far from my notes, I wouldn't even try to go back there and figure out where they're supposed to go. All right? Because I had this really neat little outline. That's how it goes sometimes. So, but there's the message that God put in my heart for you. The wonder of Christmas is God coming after you. That's the wonder of it all. Not Santa Claus, not elves tinkering around with toys. The wonder of Christmas is that God came after you. He came to get you. Came as human flesh, even went that far. And then farther to the cross, not only did he identify with our Adamic nature, but in sinless body. When he got to the cross, he became the sin-filled body. He who knew no sin became sin for us. That's how far he went to get you. And then he rose again. And instead of saying, okay, see these wounds? That's what you did to me? You've had it. Kaboom! And wipe us all out. He could have had every right to, didn't he? But all judgment was given to the Son. And when the Son rose again, what did he do with that judgment? Listen to this, please. When the Son of God rose again, after he was crucified, he rose again from the dead. He's got all power. He's got all judgment. He could wipe out the whole world right then. You know, when all this stuff finally gets done, God's going to drop kick the earth out across the heavens, a blaze and a ball of fire until the elements themselves melt in fervent heat. I mean, he's going to roll up the entire universe that he created and fold it up like an old dirty towel and toss it aside. He's going to make a new heaven, new earth when he's done. And you go through the judgments of Revelation 15 and he starts turning the sea to blood and the waters to blood and the stars start falling. And when God gets ready to drop wrath, he's well capable of dropping wrath. And all of that was put in his power. But instead of executing the wrath he has every right to execute, instead of that, he said this. Now you guys go out there and tell them that I died for them on the cross, that I was buried, and that I rose again. You go tell them all power is mine. Tell them I'm Lord. You tell them if they'll confess with their mouth the Lord Jesus and believe in their heart that God raised him from the dead, that I'll save them. You go tell them that. Isn't that wonderful? That's Christ sent. That's Christmas. Let's stand together, please, in the presence of the Lord. And consider what might be going on in your heart right now. If you're not a Christian, or sometimes it's better to put it this way because it helps clarify things. Because a lot of people call themselves Christians because they were born in a Christian home or because they're baptized in some kind of a church and things like that. So let me put the question this way to you. If you died right now, are you 100% certain that you'd go to heaven? Now you hear some murmuring and some this, that, not murmuring, but some comments and people are saying, yeah, yeah. What about you? If you died right now, are you 100% certain you'd go to heaven? Or as I was preaching, do you realize, you know what, I'm one of those darkness lovers. I'm, you know, God had my number this morning. I haven't really turned from darkness to light. I thought the deal was something like, you know, I can stay in darkness and take a ticket to heaven and put it in my back pocket. I can live in darkness here, and then when I die, I can pull my ticket out and we punch that and let me in. I didn't know you. You mean you turn from darkness to light? Yeah, you turn from darkness to light. Right. You see, if you love darkness and you love sin, something hasn't changed here that bears evidence of the presence of Christ in you. Because the amazing, I didn't get to this mystery, it's in my notes. The mystery of Christ in you, the hope of glory. God sent his Son into the world that his Son might come into our heart. And Christ in us transforms us. No, the old man's still there, but there's clearly a new man that doesn't like that old man. And a whole different thing takes place. And if you are not somebody who understands what I'm talking about, then it's very probable that you have not really encountered Christ in salvation. You've put on some religion, you've done some religious stuff, but you haven't really been born again. There's not a new man created in Christ Jesus in your testimony. It's just an old man dressing up, maybe a little better than he used to. You need to get saved. You need the mysterious gospel of Jesus Christ. And it's available to you right now if you'll repent and believe on him. Turn from darkness to light. Are you in darkness? You've been exposed by the Holy Spirit as a lover of darkness? You've been hiding in that? You've been rationalizing, justifying what you're doing? That's okay. Well, it's all right. But you know the Bible says it's wrong. You know that. All of a sudden you realize it. Uh-oh. Don't make the mistake of missing the mystery of that moment. That didn't come from your rational brain. That came from God. That's God opening your eyes. That's God showing light to you. That's God actively right now coming after you. That's what it is. So what you'll do right now is you'll decide whether you'll yield to that and respond to it by humbling yourself under the mighty hand of God and repenting and believing on Jesus, his Son, or you'll dismiss it, reject it. But one day you'll kneel. That old tongue of yours is going to wag it out. Jesus Christ is Lord. Only then it will be too late. So you can do it now, or you will do it later. I recommend you do it now. The invitation is very simple. I'm focusing the invitation almost entirely on the issue of salvation, as you see. If there's anybody in this room right now who does not know for certain you're going to go to heaven when you die, then you need to repent. Now, you can do that right where you're standing. You can bow your head where you are. You can kneel where you are. You can come up here and kneel. That's not relevant. But you need to repent of your sin and turn to Jesus Christ and be saved. It's not a religious thing. It's a faith thing. Something that goes on in your heart between you and God. But you got to confess with your mouth. That means you tell somebody about it. If you deny me before men, I'll deny you before the Father. You can't be a secret service Christian. Don't think you right now. Don't let the devil come along and say, oh, this is really cool. I like this. I can just say a little prayer. I'm saved. It's done. And don't tell anybody. Sorry. If you're sincere about this, you will want someone to know. See, if you've got that going on in your heart where you don't really want to tell anybody, you're still loving darkness. You still want to hide in darkness. So you need to tell somebody. You can do that by coming forward. You can do that by telling us afterwards. You can do that by telling somebody standing next to you, whatever. There's no religious formality about how you do that. Amen? Okay. But you got to do that. You need to repent, believe on Jesus, and tell someone you did it. Confess him before men. Then all kinds of stuff will start changing your life, but we can get into that another time. Maybe you have a question about this, though. Maybe there's something you have a question about. You know, Nicodemus didn't quite get it. He had some questions. Others, the eunuch there sitting there reading, he had some questions, so he needed some help. If you need some help sorting some things out about this, then you're welcome to step forward during the invitation, And I'll have somebody, if you're a man, a man, if you're a woman, sit down with you, open the Bible, answer your questions. Or you can wait in line a little bit and talk to me. You can talk to Pastor Sanchez or someone else. Once again, there's no religion formality here. Are you hearing me? It's not, the steps of salvation are these. You walk forward in a Baptist church and No. Salvation is yours when you confess with your mouth the Lord Jesus and believe in your heart God raised him from the dead, and in that context, call on his name to save you. All right. Hopefully I made it clear as I know how. So let's respond to God, church. Respond to the Lord.